Hey, this is Peter Dobson, and you're listening to What a Character, the podcast dedicated to character actors.
Hey everyone, this is C. Thane Dixon, and welcome to this episode of What a Character. My guest today is Lance Henriksen. In our interview, Lance will talk to us about growing up on the mean streets of New York, getting snubbed by Lee Marvin, and meeting James Cameron for the first time. It's all that and more on today's episode of What a Character. Stay tuned. Hey everyone, before we get on with the show, I just want to tell you all about how you can help make this podcast a smash hit. As many of you may know, the success of a podcast all depends on the support of the audience. A good number of subscriptions, likes, and listens can help us attract high-profile guests, thus making the podcast a success. So let's say that you enjoy this show and you want us to make more episodes. Well, you can help us make that possible by subscribing to us and leaving reviews on podcast platforms such as Spotify, iTunes, and Stitcher, by liking and subscribing to us on YouTube, or by following us on social media. You can find the links to our YouTube channel as well as our various social media feeds in the episode description. And if you're watching this on YouTube, don't forget to like and subscribe. Your help will be greatly appreciated. Now, on with the show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this episode of What a Character. Our guest today is a man who has been acting for over five decades. He's usually known for playing everything from total psychopaths to rugged heroes to tortured individuals. And believe me, he has had quite the life. This is a man who went from surviving the mean streets of New York to traveling the world as a merchant marine to painting murals all over Europe. It wasn't until the mid-60s that he decided to give acting a try and started performing in local Boston theater productions. It wasn't until later that he decided to follow his dreams to New York, where he got cast in stage productions alongside such actors as Al Pacino and John Voight. After spending many years working on the stage, he wound up getting roles in classic films such as Dog Day Afternoon, Network, Prince of the City, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and The Right Stuff. In the early 80s, he wound up getting cast in the cult classic creature feature Piranha 2, where he got the chance to work with a very young director who eventually turned him into a cult figure. That young director was a man by the name of James Cameron, who eventually cast him as Detective Vukovic in The Terminator and Bishop in Aliens. As a result of gaining prominent roles in these two hit films, he was eventually cast in roles in films like Near Dark, Pumpkinhead, Stone Cold, Hard Target, and many more. In the mid-90s, he gained his first regular TV role as criminal profiler Frank Black in the award-winning series Millennium, which ran for three seasons on the Fox network. After that, he wanted to provide his talents as a voice actor in Disney's Tarzan and Transformers Animated. Recently, he gained acclaim for his role as Willis in Viggo Mortensen's directorial debut, Falling. And aside from Bill Paxton, he's one of two actors who has been killed by an alien, a Terminator, and a Predator. Please welcome our guest, Mr. Lance Henriksen. Lance, thank you for coming on the show.
Hey, Colin. Thank you. That's a great intro.
Oh, thank you.
Now, let's spark something in me.
That's good to hear. Let's start off talking about your childhood. What was your life like growing up in New York?
I didn't go to school. I went to 3 years of grammar school, and that was it. I couldn't stand the whole thing. It was almost like a terrible political horror show. Oh. You know, teachers and the whole structure of it. It meant nothing to me. It was just abuse, you know, in a lot of ways. Because right. I couldn't read, so I'd stand in front of the class, and they would laugh at me. You know, so I thought, you know, I'm out of here. And I was. I split. I just said, no, not doing it. And so it took me a long time to learn how to read, but I did. I mean, I've educated myself through the arts. And so, anyway, more to the point, the crazy nature of what I get cast in, I'm willing to go and do it because it's an adventure. I mean, that's not school. That's not prepping. It's living. It's living it.
Right.
And I'm capable of living these fantasies and realities as well, because I don't know, the next movie I'm going to do is so exciting because it's about a turn and twist thing. It's unbelievable. It's an unbelievable script. And when I read something like that, I get real excited. So I'm preparing now. I have an acting coach, and I've got a buddy who runs lines with me incessantly until I have them pat. And I pay them. It's wonderful. I mean, I'm happy to pay. You know, I mean, it's all, now I have a complete way of working where I get to the set and I'm ready, you know, and I'm ready like for the adventure because I don't know what I'm going to do.
Right.
You don't know until you're doing it, you know, so, and you can have pretenses, but that'll show, you know, like I'm going to pull my number four now. That's bullshit. You know, so.
Right.
But it's been a wonderful life of learning. I think I would suggest anybody to try it just to see if there is a part of their desires, you know, they're having to build who you become, you know, in life and by risking, you know, so, yeah.
It's like what they say, life is the best teacher.
It is. It is. Look at us now. What is going to come out of this COVID thing? I didn't mean to bring it up.
But that's okay.
It slipped out, you know, because we're all surrounded by it and a bunch of politicians. And you know how much we all love the politicians. and listen to them talk. They just babble. And some of them are good and some of them are torturing us. So I don't like to be tortured.
No one does.
My main thing. Don't torture me. No. That was a hell of a speech you made, man, at beginning of this. It's really, I didn't realize until recently I'd done, I think it's 260 movies. So.
So at what point in your childhood did you become enamored with the art of acting and just art in general?
I think my ability to lie was really cultivated by my parents. You know, I could really pour it on. And there wasn't guilt because I wasn't particularly religious, you know, that I'm going to go to hell because I tell a lie. And that's the beginning of it, because it's all a lie, really, when you get down to it. Moment to moment is truthful, and you experience it. But in reality, the whole thing is a lie. It's a story. It's what people used to do back in the 1400s, where they'd sit around a fireplace, get drunk because the water was bad, so they would drink instead, and tell stories. And that's really where these things begin. I have a good one. You know, I mean, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now we've added to it all the digital and the visuals are amazing. I mean, I'm on YouTube a lot, watching a lot of, like stuff from Venezuela and Japan and China and everywhere. And I'm gobbling it up. I've never seen so much in my life. You know, it's like,
I know.
I realize I got 20, I've watched 23 episodes of Simon Bolivar and loved every minute of it. You know, whole thing. It's all in Spanish, but they have, you know, a little, what do you call it? You have to read it too.
The subtitles. That's the beauty of this whole streaming age that we're in, is that all this foreign content is easily available now. Like back in the day, you'd have to probably find like a bootleg tape or something, but now you could just, you know, go on your computer and find it with subtitles and everything.
Wow. And then you, I mean, there's one from Israel that's a cop movie from Israel. And I never saw such good acting. I mean, it was like, these guys are real, man. This is not BS, you know. And the stakes are real. So it's like, wow, you know, and the Palestinian actors and all of that. It's just amazing. I have no idea where we're headed, all of us, you know, but it's, man, there's a lot of opportunity to immerse yourself, you know, so.
Right.
Instead of judge, just immerse and see what happens, see how you feel.
Yeah. Right. So how did your experiences in the Navy and as a painter shape you as a person and as an actor?
Yeah, because it is a social thing. I mean, the reason you paint something is because you have the skill. And then when other people look at it, they get excited that they have a little of that skill, or they like it because it's broad. And fearless, if you can be fearless, you know, instead of compulsive, you know. But yeah, it's all about community. I mean, I don't really think that. I mean, when I watch some of these shows in a language I don't even understand, I'm starting. Oh, I'll tell you a good one. Falling premiered at the Macau International Film Festival in China. And I won Best Actor.
Wow.
I was shocked because it's an American-themed story. I mean, it's all about a farm, a family, and, you know, I mean, and our world. And they saw it and connected. I mean, it's like that took a lot of votes. A lot of votes. And Viggo's work with this movie, the cutting and how he told that story is unbelievable. I mean, it was a journey when we did it. It was like there was no acting. This was going on, you know, and winter was going on. And, you know, everything lent itself because of his focus directing. It was great.
Was this shot pre-COVID or during COVID?
What?
Was Falling a shot before COVID or during COVID?
I can't remember now. I guess I don't want to. But I think toward the end of the movie, it was all happening, you know.
COVID. Right.
I had to fly to London and do the dubbing and, you know, do stuff like that. And I remember having to, you know, this thing up your nose that, I mean, they have found a way to invade our bodies, our minds.
I know. We're living in an episode of Millennium.
Good morning, Lance. And it goes like D'Artagnan sticking his sword up your nose.
It's not a pleasant feeling. I know. I know what you're talking about.
Not good. But in order, I'm not trying to tell you that because I want it and I'm talking about how great I am. That's not what I'm doing. I just want you to know that even a foreign country, that their whole world is different than ours, but they're open to things. And so it was like amazing. Because it was in English, it wasn't dubbed into Chinese. It had subtitles for them, you know.
Yeah, it's amazing what movies play over there and what movies don't. Like you'll have some American films that are like comedies, and then they go to China, and then somehow by accident, you know, they become a hit film, even though you know their sense of humor is different.
Right now, for instance, I mean, to have 32 episodes about Simon Bolivar, from the time he was a little kid to the time he was, the president of all of Latin America.
Right.
You see wonderful acting and romances and all kinds of stuff, man. And it wouldn't even be done here. Nobody in America would do that. They wouldn't waste the money. You know, it would, right. For that, it would be the waste of money. But I don't know. There are so many talented people in the world that some societies have more money for that. And they don't make as much as we do, but that's okay. You know what I mean?
Right.
Doesn't matter. I've been to some countries where, you know, like, I don't want to mention them. I don't want to talk down about anybody, you know, but,
right.
But it's all been an adventure. I've gone to so many countries of the world. I worked in, you know, the ones, you know, I mean, Australia and, but Romania and other countries, Bulgaria, and, you know, I've been all over the world. I mean,
what's it like shooting in Bulgaria? I've always heard scary stories about what it's like making movies there.
I think the biggest stories you probably hear is about what hotel somebody stayed in.
Oh.
You know, I remember doing a film about it was a ripoff of a movie that we did in America where they injected like a spaceship into the body of a human to try to stop a nuclear bomb from going off. And it's absurd. I mean, and when I went to Romania, not only was that story absurd, but the spaceship that I was in was all made of wood. Robin Givens was with me, and she was a scientist. Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Okay. and the spaceship seats and everything were made of wood. I mean, and I thought, if you can overcome this, you're going to do well. So it turned into a slight comedy, you know.
Wow.
But those experiences are not terrible. They're just... I remember going into a coffee shop in Bulgaria, and it's all in Cyrillic.
Mm-hmm.
So I said to the guy, cappuccino, because that's universal, you know, cappuccino. Right. And the guy went, and as he walked away, I said, what's the problem? I smell it. You make it, you know, and the guy comes back with a cappuccino. I went, what the hell just happened? And the truth is that this means yes over there, and this means no.
Oh, just, wow.
And I went, okay, I'll put that in my book. You know, I mean, I'll put that in my memory book. And I really did come up with a use for that. But anyway.
Despite having a rough life early on, you've always managed to find positivity. What was always your secret to hanging on in spite of tragedy?
It's a desperation. You know, I ran away from home when I was 12, and I went all the way across the country. And I was at 12, I didn't look 12. I looked younger. And I rode freight trains and hitchhiked. And what happened was I realized I have a street smart that's from New York. From where I was raised in the streets, you know, I shined shoes in New York, you know, as a little kid to make money to go watch movies. And I did.
Right.
A lot of movies that dumped out at 5 a.m. I'd watch it twice or 3 times. And then I'd get my ass whipped because I was disappeared, you know. But anyway, it was all like the adventure is the part of it, because I couldn't rely on people. All the people in my life as a child were on their own journey, and I couldn't. I was there, but I wasn't, you know what I mean? I was there. And so that world of the arts, of movies and other things, plays. I used to sneak into the Broadway plays, because what would happen is they'd let out at intermission. And then what you do is go in with everybody and find a seat. And I watched half of all the Broadway plays that were on.
Wow.
Yeah.
What plays did you get to see?
Oh, God. oh God, Evita with Patti LuPone. And I saw, I was free as a bird because nobody really gave a shit if I fell off the Brooklyn Bridge, you know, didn't.
Right.
It'd be all right. Well, we don't have to bury him. He's gone.
Tell us a story about your first paid acting gig and your run-in with Lee Marvin.
That was ridiculous. I mean, he came to a, I got picked up for vagrancy. And I think I was 15, something like that, in the South.
Mm-hmm.
Phoenix, Arizona, I think it was, or it was Tucson, or it was, I think it was right on the border of California. Yuma, it was.
Oh, okay.
Yuma was right on the border of California. I think they said, would you guys like to, they were asking the prisoners, and they were giving everybody $5 to march out in the compound, you know. Mm-hmm. So I did, and I asked the guys that were making the movie, like the lighting guys and stuff, and I said, can you get me out of here? Because I'm in here for vagrancy, and $5 is not enough to get me out.
Right.
They said, oh, sure. And I never saw him again. My first push with reality of movies. They're not real.
Now, in the mid-60s, you decided to fully pursue a career as an actor. What inspired you to make that leap from working as a potter and painter to working as an actor?
Well, you know, it was really hit or miss because there were a lot of plays going on off Broadway. And my first play that I got was in Herbert Berghoff Studios, was doing a Three Plays of the Sea. And it was Eugene O'Neill, and it was like Bound East for Cardiff, In the Zone. And there were three of them. And I got the lead and didn't even know it. I had the lead in it. The character was one of the lead. And the cast was huge. I mean, it was all, it was all semen and everything. The guy said, well, I'd like you to read for it. And at the time, I couldn't read. Mm-hmm. I mean, my reading was like, duh, you know, very struggling for every word. But anyway, what happened was, I said, you know something? I just got off a ship, and what I could do is build your set. The whole forecastle of the ship, the bow, mm-hmm. and the deck, and all of the accoutrements that go with a ship, because I know them all. And the guy said, really? And I said, yeah, I would do that. You know, it's a month away from the opening. And so he said, oh, that is great. I, if you'd really do that, I'd be really happy because you know your stuff, right? Because I told him everything. And,
right.
and he said, okay, let's read. He got excited. He went, let's read. And I went, and I could do the lighting. And he went, what? No shit. So it was this big con job I was doing. So I didn't have to read because I knew that if I'm building the set and all of that shit, I'll have plenty of time to learn these lines. I put them all on tape. I had somebody put them on tape for me. And I memorized everything from tape. Nobody knew, you know, so.
Right.
And then we did the show, and it was a real hit for an off Broadway, you know. We had a full house every night. And I learned a great deal from that, man. It was one of the reviews. Mel Gusso reviewed me. I remember we went to Sardi's to have a beer because that's traditional. If you're on Broadway or off Broadway, you go to Sardi's and you have a beer. And then somebody came running in with the New York Times, and there was my picture was in it. And I went, what the fuck?
Wow.
What just happened? Anyway, that's the romantic part. And it really was because And it is a romantic business. You fall in love with this girl and that girl and this girl and that girl. You know what I mean? They're,
right.
And then you find out you suck at falling in love. You know, it really sucks. Every girl in New York had a cat box with a cat. And I can't stand the smell of cat shit. It's like, more. Anyway, I was sleeping on couches. I had no money for a long, long time. And begging forgiveness. But anyway, over the years, I mean, you find that your story comes directly from your childhood, and you're the one that brought that up. And it's true. All the incidents of my childhood propelled me as much as made me duck in a certain way. I mean, I was very good at ducking. You couldn't hit me because I was so fast.
Now, how did you make your way from the Boston theater community to the New York theater community?
Well, Boston had theater company in Boston, and they let me do some plays up there, you know, and it was a great learning experience. I don't know if I was very good. I was a charming piece of meat, but I don't know how deep I got into some of these things, you know. I mean, and as I have progressed in my life as an actor, I work harder on it and try to come up with something that I can do, that I can really do, and it's worked. Like, I remember you brought up Bishop, and Bishop, I had to go fly to London and audition. Because the law in England is, if there is a British person that could do that role and is better than me, then I wouldn't get the role. But I auditioned for Jim, and he already knew me. I mean, it was like, and he said, if I'd found somebody better, I would have hired them. And I said, oh, okay. Well, I got lucky. But anyway. So what happened, I had decided that the innocence of Bishop came from the idea that he had and no animus toward anything. All he wanted to do was help. That was his. And so I thought, if I was a young black kid in South Africa during apartheid, I would feel that way. I would feel that I was under threat at any given time, but I wouldn't fight it. I was more of a, I just wouldn't know how to fight it. So, and I remember Sigourney knocking a pan out of my hand, and cornbread went all over the floor. And I got down on my hands and knees and picked it all up really carefully and wrote it back. And that proved to me that I was right about that, because what other emotion would I have, you know?
Right.
And so there was a click that happened about Bishop, that I found great innocence in him, in that character. He had great innocence, and it actually paid off, because later that was like one of the things that people liked about that character. And so, you know, it's a constant growth, an actor, layers of successes and failures and ideas.
How did you transition from acting in the theater to acting in films in the early 70s?
There wasn't any. Because what I felt was, you're going to find me. I'm not looking for you. I'm not looking for, where's the camera, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Let the camera chase me. I don't want to chase the fucking camera. Excuse my French, but
it's okay.
It's machinery, you know, any more than I chase. I don't watch stuff on my computer. That's a taboo. I need a big screen. I need, you know,
right.
This new shit they come out with, you know, YouTube and HBO and all of that, they've done some really good stuff, because they're not condemned to perfection. They can give you a sampling of something, and that's good enough, because it doesn't have to have all of that. What you see when you see a really good movie shot well, and all the work you have to do that. So it's some of the shows are very quick, and they're very, a lot of good actors out there that are just want to live it too. Because when you're living it, that's what it's about. Like, it's like scoring with your girlfriend. You know, you did something that they really liked, and you didn't even know you were doing it. Now you won, and you get along for about a week or two, and then you move on. What a thing to say. But
now, you got the chance to work with the great Sidney Lumet. What was it like working with him?
What a kind man. I mean, Sidney, everybody knows that Sidney loved New York actors. And he wanted to do all his movies forever in New York. And then he went and did one with Paul Newman up in Boston. But that's pretty close to New York. I mean, it's, you know, it's got the New York feel, but it's a Boston feel. But he wanted that. But anyway, he would always hire young, out-of-work actors and give them a job, you know. Right. I remember I was very late one... I had a buddy who's a Cuban guy named Lazaro Perez. He was a great guy. He's passed away, but he was from Cuba. And he got into the actor's studio. I mean, he wanted to be an actor, and he was an actor. But he got into the actor's studio, and he heard that I got the job of an FBI guy in Dog Day, where I shot him at the airport and killed him, you know. Mm-hmm. But anyway, he said, "Lance, come on, let's go to my house. We get a bottle of red wine and we just sit there and celebrate that you got that job." So we did, you know, we sit around talking and laughing and carrying on. And I didn't realize how much we had drank, because I don't drink a lot, you know, I just don't. And I wake up, and I was supposed to be on a set in Brooklyn by 8 o'clock. And it was 8 o'clock when I woke up. So now I go, "Oh shit." And I run out of Lazaro's house, run down to the subway, ride the subway all the way out to Brooklyn, get off. And I realized if I don't run into makeup and also wardrobe, then I'm going to screw up. I might get fired on the first day.
You know? Wow.
My first day. So I did. I went in and put my suit on and they did the makeup, and I came out on, it was lucky that there was a scene with about 500 people on the street. And me and my partner, FBI guy, were standing there just witnessing all of this, trying to come up with a strategy for how we're going to take this guy down, you know, and because he's making a big show. He's out on the street going, "Attica, Attica," you know, carrying on shit. And Sidney looks, he's right across the street from me. And he looks at me, and I know he knows I'm late. And I felt as guilty as a four-year-old that just stole all the cookies and ate them. He goes, "Feels like shit, doesn't it?" And I went, "Yeah." Nothing was ever said again.
That's the amazing thing about Sidney. He wasn't like the typical angry, egotistical director. He always seemed like such a calm guy.
It was all passion. It was all. I mean, he was the kindest guy. That's an example of his kindness. We were doing a scene where we're loading into the airplane van. You know, we had all the hostages, and he says, Pacino's character says to me, "You, I want you to drive," because I must have looked sort of like dumb in his eyes. And so, as as he was searching me to see if I had a gun on me, I realized if I look at him, if I look, because he's below me, if I look at him, I'm going to kill him right there, right then. Just crush his head. And we shot that part of the scene. And Sidney said, "Lance, I don't know what you're doing, but keep doing it." I said, "Yeah, all right." But it's that affirmation, that these little affirmations along the way of your career that make you believe in yourself, that you know how, you know what you're doing and how to do it. And so to some degree, not 100% ever, but, you know, but anyway, it was like, I think that's the biggest thing we can get out of this affirmation. On the way to the airport, by the way, John Casals was a friend. Everybody in the van was friends. Penny Allen and now John Casals and all these people. And on the, I had to open up the side of the door, the driver's door, and there's the gun. And I would turn, I say, "Hey, Sal, you know, listen, we don't want any accidents, so keep that gun pointed up, okay? We might hit a bump or something." But the problem was that I liked him so much, and he had this great look. I mean, but it made me laugh, because, you know, it's him sitting there with a gun, a machine gun. And we started laughing, and we couldn't stop. It was like a laughing jag. Have you ever had one of those?
Yeah.
God, we're laughing and laughing. And then, meanwhile, they're putting lights on the van and everything. Luckily, because if we tried to do the same, we couldn't do it. I'm telling you, my stomach was hurting from laughing. I guess it was the thought of shooting him was like really getting to me, and it was getting him too. I'm going to get shot. Anyway. But those little moments and those affirmations and everything, yeah, it's like that kind of covers how I work. I wasn't schooled like at even the Actor's Studio. I went and auditioned to be in the Actor's Studio, and they said, "We don't." I was doing a scene out of a play with the same girl that I did the play. It's a play called Saved by James Bond, not James Bond, by a guy named Bond. Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, Cockney young people. I was young, I was only 30. And so he said, we don't take people from like England into the Actor's Studio. My buddy Lazaro was already a member. He said he's not from England. He's from New York, and he's acting.
Wow,
Cockney. He's doing a Cockney. And then they made me an observer, but I didn't like being there very much. That was traditional acting classes and shit.
What do you do when you're an observer at the Actor's Studio?
You come into everything that they're doing, whether it's a play or whether it's just a whole group talking about somebody doing a scene on the stage. I did a scene with Francesca Di Sapio, who is an incredible Italian actress. And when I was in Italy, we actually got in touch because she lives in Italy. But she, Francesca Di Sapio, in Godfather 2, where she was playing De Niro's wife. Beautiful Italian.
Oh, okay. I know who you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. She's stunningly beautiful. Mm. Anyway, I got to rub elbows over the years with a lot of really good actors. I mean, wonderful actors, wonderful people. And here I am, and I'm in Agua Dulce. What the hell am I doing out here? when I look out the window, there's nothing but barren hills, you know, and just this shit. You know.
Right.
But I like it. I built the place, so it's exactly what I kind of wanted.
Very cool.
Simple. Yeah.
What do you remember about working with François Truffaut and in Close Encounters of the Third Kind?
Oh, yeah. That was crazy, man. He was about 5'4" or 5'5", maybe 5'5". Mm-hmm. And he wore great clothes. I mean, suits. I mean, French cut suits.
Right.
And he would walk in a restaurant. We would go into a restaurant. And every woman I watched, every woman in the fucking, excuse me, in the place. Yeah, he was like a god of women. Right. They loved him. Any woman that talked to him was swooning, you know, and they were. He had a charisma with women I've never witnessed in my life ever before. You know, I mean, that's crazy. But he was the kindest man. I remember this is the event of my life in that movie, during that movie. I had watched 400 Blows. It's a movie he made about a kid like me at my, you know, my childhood, who was thrown away by his parents, put into a home, like an orphanage. And he was all about trying to be free, to free himself from the oppression of parents. And it's a beautiful movie. It really is. And I saw it when I was 15 in the theater in black and white. And it was, and I said, who would make a story about my childhood? Holy wow. Shit. I was so surprised because I had been thrown into Catholic boarding schools, Hastings on the Hudson Boys School, the Norwegian Children's Home. They kept getting rid of me. Every time my mother remarried, they'd throw me away. And so when I met Truffaut, and we were having lunch and stuff and talking, and I never mentioned 400 Blows. I mentioned Jules and Jim. I mentioned Fahrenheit 451. And we talked about those movies. But I never mentioned 400 Blows. I didn't want to let that go. And so we do the whole movie. We flew to India. You know, we worked down in Wyoming, the Devil's Mountain, all that stuff, and in different places. And at the end of the movie, we were all going to split. We were done. The movie was done. We all had sore throats from them making so much smoke with the big tanks of mineral oil. It gave us all like snot balls and sore throats, you know. But anyway, so we're all getting ready to go. And I go to my trailer, and I was in a honey wagon, and there's a package laying there. And I opened the package, and it's a copy of 400 Blows. And he had written on it, "You are now and I've always been that kid."
Wow.
I started crying like a baby. I mean, it was so moving that he had drawn that thing. He had unraveled.
Did you tell him about your childhood?
No.
Wow.
I remember I would stay on set because I didn't want to miss anything. It's a big movie, and it was, you know. And he said, "You can't do that." So he got me a book on Josh Logan making movies, right?
Right.
And he said, "I'm going to quiz you. I want you to go to your trailer and read it when you're not working." And I said, "Okay." And I only read one chapter. When he quizzed me, I talked to him about the chapter with Marlon Brando where Josh Logan made the mistake of doing two takes with Marlon. The first one, Marlon did nothing. The second take, he did a lot. But Josh Logan, Josh Logan said, I made the mistake of picking the first take where Marlon did nothing for the rest of Tea House in the August Moon. I mean, look at the interesting roads we're talking about. You know, if you're right. If you're watching. And then, so he was that kind of guy, you know, and meanwhile, I'd get up at 4 a.m. and I went out and learned to fly. I get up at 4, fly till 8. We landed on the same runway that was right in front of the hangar where we were working. And I'd get out and go to work. I could barely afford it, but I did it. I soloed and everything.
Wait, you actually flew a plane?
Yeah, solo.
Wow.
They stopped me when I was going to jump, you know, parachute jump. They sent an AD out and said, no, you can't.
It's amazing. Who taught you how to fly on that film? Did you have like these ace Air Force guys?
A local guy. A really kind guy. Wonderful guy. Yeah.
Now, in 1981, you starred in Piranha 2, which was not only James Cameron's debut feature, but also the first movie you did with him. What was your first impression of James Cameron, and how did you hit it off so well?
I had called the producer. I had done one other movie with him called, I don't even want to tell you the name of it, but it's a movie in Italy where I was the young guy. I was the gigolo, and there was a bunch of strange people around me, and I had no idea what that movie was about, called The Visitor. It was
with Franco Nero and Martin Balsam, I think so.
But I love I mean, I was in Italy for the first time and went and bought linen suits and shit, you know. I mean, but anyway, so the reason I brought that up is the same producer. So as Piranha 2. Mm-hmm. So I went down, I called him before and I said, I have to drive a boat in this, I'm a harbor cop. And I went down and I said, I have to try it, you know, so I don't want to wreck it. So I get there, they have no wardrobe. We're borrowing the boat from a guy, paying him. And also, so I have no wardrobe. So I see a waiter at an outdoor restaurant who's my size. And I said, can I buy your clothes? And he said, what? And so, but it had a stripe down. They were like a Camino, what do you call it? They looked like it could be a cop or it could be a doorman or whatever. And I have Save the Whale pins, my shoulder bag, Save the Whale and, you know, all of that stuff. So I bought it from him. You weren't allowed to have a gun down in Jamaica. So I carved my own gun for the holster and Save the Whale pins on my epaulets. And turned them upside down so you couldn't read it. And it turned myself into a harbor cop. So that was my tenacity. And I was watching Jim's tenacity, who made a mountain out of crap. He really did. He had miniatures. We had the whole crew making miniature boats that have to blow up in the parking lot. And all of that kind of stuff. So what I ended up, the first scene I was in was to pull up by a pier. They didn't let me learn how to use the boat. So I ended up putting the boat up on the pier. Mm-hmm. You should have seen the owner of it. You know, the guy was a big, huge Jamaican guy. And look what you did to my boat, man. And it was like flipping out. I said, Jim, you said you would get between me and that guy. So have at it.
You got the chance to work with Rip Torn in the film The Hit List. What do you remember about working with him?
Oh, he was a powerhouse. That guy was a powerhouse. And he was really kind, man. He's, you know, I liked him a lot. I did. Because I was trying to raise my game to the point where he would believe me that I was capable of killing and have done it in the past, you know. So, right. I mean, so I had to raise my game in order to get him. I just wanted him to believe me. It's all I needed. And I
Moving on to the right stuff, tell us about prepping for the role of Wally Schirra.
Oh, you know, we were all so happy to be in that movie because NASA, to us, you know, you have the astronauts and you have Ames Research and you've got stuff out at up here, you know, where the whole culture of NASA was seemed to be squeaky clean and absolutely, we were like, I don't know. Spam in the can was an unfortunate description by the writer of the book. Not, you know, and we even made a point of it in the movie. I mean, the director did that's not true at all. I mean, you can use that analogy if you want to be cute, but really those guys in the early days of the seven astronauts, those seven, Mercury seven, there, nothing was known. This was all the unknown. And so they had things to figure out what would happen if you freaked out in the capsule, what would happen. You know, they tried to push every button in the human, you know, but they're dealing with pilots, by the way. So they're not going to flip out because you're feeling something different, you know, like weightless. And then it was a very political time. We were after beating the Russians because the Russians had already done it, but we wanted to orbit, you know. And anyway, it was a race to space. It wasn't, you know, that story, the right stuff. You know, they made fun of us, all the other pilots, the test pilots would make fun of us because we had shot a monkey up there and a dog, you know. I mean, so they didn't open that door very nicely for us, you know. And so, but as a lot had happened in you know, at NASA over the years between the real period, which was in, you know, in the 60s, and then while we were making the movie. So we had so much more knowledge that we could emotionally handle it. The stuff that was going on was just trite, you know, and it was goofy, some of it, goofy. You know, some of the tests were really goofy. They were, you know. But anyway, the truth of it is, it was a great feeling to rub elbow with NASA and Ames Research and all of that. It was great. We all felt as patriotic as the flag, you know, while we were making the movie. I had a dream, and this really happened. I had a dream that Wally Schirra came to me in a dream and said, go over to, which was, you just drive straight over to Nevada. He said, go into a casino to a roulette wheel and bet on these numbers. He gave me like five numbers, bet on them. Don't drink, no dames, and just bet those numbers. And I was off the next day and it was a snowstorm and I drove over to Nevada.
Wow.
Bet those numbers and won enough to buy a GTO.
Wow. Yeah, that's divine intervention right there.
I know. It was a dream. But I follow my dreams, man. And you come and tell me that, you know, it's like, oh, shit, I'm going. I came back and all the guys were like blown away. They were going, what the fuck? Mr. Magic.
Did you get to meet with the real Wally Shearer when you worked on The Right Stuff?
Yeah, he leaned down to me and said, he was sitting right behind me at the Kennedy Center in Washington, because we got invited to the White House as well.
Oh, wow.
And this kid from New York who shines shoes. Don't think I didn't remember that. But anyway, he leaned over and he says, "Hey, Lance, I think they think I didn't do anything." I wanted to tell you, I was wearing my flight jacket from the movie. So it was Lieutenant Commander Sharar, Wally Sharar. So the tax guy must have come to the show and said, "We saw you win a whole shitload of money on a roulette."
Wow.
But I thought, uh-oh, I'm going to pay for this.
Now, you were very good friends with legendary stunt writer Rex Rossi. How did you manage to strike up a friendship with him?
With who?
Rex Rossi.
Oh, God, Rex. I'm trying to remember how we met. Rex became the godfather of my daughter. I have two daughters, and Rex wanted to be my godfather, her godfather. And, you know, and my wife at the time actually painted an Indian head on his motorcycle. Rex rode a motorcycle all the time. He was either on a horse or a motorcycle, but he was a great stuntman from the early days. You know, he actually doubled Tyrone Power in Zorro, did all of the sword fighting and this. Jumping and leaping. He had the strongest legs of any stuntman around. Any stuntman would tell you that. He could run up a wall.
Wow.
I mean, but Rex, I'm trying to remember how we met.
Was it on one of your Westerns, or was it earlier than that?
It was, but I'm trying to remember which one, because for a while I did a whole series of Westerns, different characters.
Did you meet on Gunfighter's Moon or maybe Quick and the Dead?
I'm sorry?
Did you meet on Gunfighter's Moon?
Oh, no. But Gunfighter's Moon was a wonderful story about him. Rex and I, we didn't want to do bullshit Westerns. You know, I mean, we wanted to have ways of getting on and off of horses or whatever we were going to do. Original, kind of something original. Mm-hmm. And they had me at one point in the only scene where I shoot a gun is, well, a couple of them. But anyway, I shoot a bullet through a card, a vase of spades that this girl is holding up. And instead of just standing in the street and shooting it, I said, "Rex, this guy's a showman. It's like you, it's like what you are." And so we came up with that, me flipping off the back and shooting under the belly. We came up with that. And then when we got up to Tucson, I showed Sam Raimi that. I asked the stunt guys to bring out a white horse, And so when we did it, Sam Raimi was very young and he was so excited. He said, no, that's in the movie. That's definitely in the movie. Because I flipped off and shot the card and all of that. And it was kind of original. And that was Rex's kind of thinking. He was always able to come up with something, you know, how I mount a horse or how I don't. And I became a very good rider because of him. You know, it was like, he was my buddy. He was part of my family. He met a girl up in Shasta in his late 80s. Rex never really told anybody his real age. Because he works in Tom Hanks's circus and all of this over the years. I mean, that's a long time ago.
And how old was he when he was working in the 90s? He must have been in his 70s or 80s.
I think, 80s at least. Wow. You know, he went on and probably until his 90s. He was the greatest trick rider ever. He'd stand on the back of a horse and rope, and you couldn't.
Wow.
Yeah, he was amazing. But anyway, he went up there and then he passed away. But he was like, he was up in Mount Shasta with a new girlfriend, about half his age.
Wow. What do you remember the most about working with Sam Raimi on Quick and the Dead?
I really think that the excitement of having any piece of equipment that he wanted to shoot, any shot that he wanted, was in his hands, And he was excited, I mean, every minute of the day. Nothing could deter him. It was a beautiful sight, really. The woman that did my wardrobe in that mm-hmm. was a German lady who is one of the best costumers in the world, I think. And it was just amazing. And it gave me the character in a way. I put it on and I was sitting out on a porch and in the town. And it was dark. And I thought, if I was sitting by a fire campsite with this outfit on and these guns, these beautiful guns, and a bunch of thieves rode by, they would take everything I had. They'd shoot me first and then take everything. And I thought that was the Old West. The Old West was a horrible fucking place.
Oh, yeah.
Well, in so many ways. I mean, it's people turning other people into less than them, you know, so.
Right. Now, before we leave, we're going to take a couple of fan questions. Usually when I do a podcast, I like to put a questionnaire out in different Facebook and social media groups. So here we go. Henry Ossier asks, is the outfit you wore in Quick of the Dead the same one you wore in Dead Man?
No. Completely different. And I had all silver teeth made because the guy he was in a rage all the time because he had toothaches back in the day. Toothaches. If you had a toothache, you were half dead, you know. I mean, so no, it wasn't different, totally different. He should get just compare them, totally different. I don't keep anything from movies. I give them away. There was a coat that I made for Near Dark that we made. I had a great customer on that one too, but I wanted a specific kind of look where I sewed a rebel flag inside and all of this stuff. Because what I gave myself for that character was that I was in the Southern Navy on an ironclad, and we got destroyed and by more of a monitor kind of ironclad, and we drifted through the marshes, men lying on the deck dying, their chests split open and steaming into the night, and no. So the whole point I'm trying to bring up is that the creation of the character is a very big percentage of the wardrobe and how well it's done and what it represents, you know, that kind of thing. So there's that whole element, you know, it's like an art piece. I mean, everybody on a movie is working with an art piece, especially when you get into the Old West. I mean, the Italians do sweat and handkerchiefs and embroidered shirts, where the Americans do a whole other thing. I mean, you want to be your own thing, you know, every movie. So anyway, did I answer your question?
Yes, you did. Darren Smith asks, when you get a script, do you check first to see when your character dies in the film?
I only die half the time, but Yes, I do. And how he dies.
Anthony Gibbons asks, is there any chance of a revival of Millennium?
I doubt it. We're going to have a party here on the 1st of October where directors that worked on it and other actors that are with it and, you know, that were with us, and we're going to have a party right here at my house. So it's the 25th year since Millennium.
Wow.
Yeah. 25 years ago. And we're still hanging on, you know. I don't know if it'll ever be done. I've been wanting to do a movie of it.
I don't understand why Disney or Fox just doesn't like go back and remaster those episodes and release them on Hulu. It's ripe for rediscovery.
Yeah. It's almost an impossibility. You know, everybody's gone on.
Right.
Yeah.
Bill Jackson asks, have you ever been offered a script that was so bad and so ridiculous that you just had to turn it down?
Yes, I have. And I'm not going to tell you which one. Yes. I mean, of course. I mean, and it's always this way. I want you to star in this movie, and we don't have the money yet, but if you agree to do it, you know, like give us a thing that says you will do it. And usually the script is pretty lumpy. You know, it just doesn't, it's not a good script. It's a tangible dream for the guy that wrote it. That's what it is. But that's not a script necessarily, you know. Yep. I have one right now that my jaw dropped. It was so good. And I'm going to go do it. So, but it's like, you don't know who, what, where, when, or how a movie's going to happen for you. Mm-hmm. And so think of all of the elements that are in that it takes to go do a movie. How many elements, business-wise, everything else, you know? It's incredible. It's an incredible phenomenon. And it's changing. It's altering, you know?
Right. Well, Lance, thank you so much for appearing on this episode of What a Character. You've been a great guest. When your next movie comes out, please come back on and let's talk about it.
All right, Colin. Yeah, it's really cool. You're out in Florida doing this. With wallpaper behind you that fits.
This isn't wallpaper. I'm on an actual movie set.
Are you really?
No.
See, that's what it is. It's a dream machine. Thank you, buddy. Thanks for your interest.
You're very welcome, sir.
Well, that about wraps it up for our interview with Lance Henriksen. If you want to check out Fallen, which is one of his most recent films, you can find it on streaming platforms such as Amazon Prime, YouTube, Hulu, and Roku. And if you're a horror movie buff, then you might want to check out Lance's latest film, Unhealer. This film can be streamed for free on Tubi or Amazon Prime. The film is essentially about a bullied teenage boy who uses his supernatural powers to take revenge on those who have done him wrong. In the film, Lance plays a faith healer who is hired to rein the boy in, so to speak. So if you are into supernatural horror films, you might want to consider giving it a view. Now, before we end this episode, I just want to remind you that if you love the show and you want us to grow in popularity, you can help us do that by rating and reviewing this podcast. You can leave us a rating or review on iTunes or Spotify or whatever platform you stream and download podcasts from. You can even leave a review of our podcast on our website at whatacharacterpodcast.com. Just click on Rate Show and you'll be taken to a page where you can give your critique of the show. And while you're there, you can even donate to our podcast by clicking on the PayPal link and submitting your desired amount. And don't forget to subscribe to our email mailing list if you want to receive email alerts about upcoming shows or even receive email exclusive episodes of our show. You can do this by typing in your name and email address on the right side of the homepage and clicking on subscribe. Now, if you want to reach out to us, please feel free to do so. If you have any guest suggestions or you just want to tell us how great you think the show is, you can do so by sending us an email at westgrovemedia@gmail.com. You could even leave us a voice message on the show website by clicking on the microphone button on the bottom right and recording a message. And please subscribe to this podcast on whatever platform you stream and download podcasts from. And if you watch us on YouTube, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And hey, if you're watching this on YouTube right now, please give this video a like. All in all, your support will definitely help us not only make the podcast successful, but it will be greatly appreciated as well. Anyway, that about does it for this episode of What a Character. Join us next week for our interview with Peter Dobson, where he will talk to us about playing the Val Kilmer role in the original version of Heat, acting alongside Sylvester Stallone in a lost movie, and nabbing Joe Pesci for his upcoming feature film. It's all that and more on next week's episode of What a Character. Thank you for listening and take it easy. Bye.
Hey, Bishop, man. Do the thing with the
knife. Oh, please.
Oh, come on, yeah.
Come on. Do it, man. It's
all right. Yeah.
Check us out. I don't
want to
see that, man.
Come
on, man.
All right. Hey, what are you doing, man? Hey, what are you doing?
Don't
come on, quit messing around, Drake. Come on. Bishop? Hey, man.
Do it, Bishop.
Hey, not me, man.
Yeah, you.
Hey, come on, quit messing around.
Don't move.
Come on.
Trust me.
No. You know what you ought to get?
Enjoy your meal.
That wasn't funny, man.